Buenos días. Bon dia, good morning. Well, I've been introduced. I think the most relevant thing is I'm a Pandas core developer. I'm part of the Pandas team, and I'm going to share mostly about the discussions and the future plans for Pandas. Just to justify, right, because this talk is talking about the future of Pandas, which means changing Pandas, which means some sort of criticism. So just to it out, I think it's worth showing like how Pandas is serving the users today. This is the installations via PIP from 5 million to 8 million in just 6 month frame, I think. PIP is not a great tool for installing Pandas. Conda is even more impressive in, I think this is a time frame of 2 years, like from 50,000 installations to 250,000, so 5 times more in 2 years. Stack Overflow, a bit more objective metric, is saying that we are growing like crazy in their questions. That's, I think, like a couple of years old, this data. Our website also is showing a growth of around like 3 times in a period of around 2 years too. So all the metrics show that Pandas is serving well the community and it's quite widely used. So any criticism that you see here doesn't mean that Pandas is not a great tool. It means that Pandas can be improved, and that's surely true. I shown that for the ones that were at the plenary session yesterday, they saw a bit handicapped version of this part, where I explained what we've been working during the last year, since the beginning of the year in Pandas. I mentioned the first thing is like we support like integer values with missing value, with missing data. In the past, every time you have a missing value in a integer column, basically it's get casted to float. This is because none is a float value. None doesn't have a representation as an integer. And what we did is implement a new type that lets you have missing values in integer data. That is still somehow experimental. It's not as stable as the other. It's not coming by default. You need to use this type specifically. But this is working. Also, joining in multi-index, imagine we have some data about some projects on the number of stars on GitHub. And for the same information, we have the versions. And until 0.24, you couldn't do that, but now you can join on multi-indices, and it gets like the results with the two columns. Okay, sparse data frame, not many people use that, but it's something we deprecated. Now we have a normal data frame that supports sparse columns, and if you check the value of the series, you see that the type of the column is a sparse type. And in 0.25, we stopped support for Python 2. We're Python 3 compatible only. We're getting rid of compatibility with Python 3.5 soon, very soon in the next version. So it would be Python 3.6 compatible only, which means that we'll be able to use F strings and other cool stuff on the latest versions of Python in our code. We're also removing a lot of code that was deprecated, like panel. Implemented a new feature. We don't implement many features. Pandas is quite big already, but we implemented something named explode. You have this data frame where a column is a list of other values. And if you explode this column, it becomes a data frame where you have like a row for every value on that list. And we're supporting the new backends for plotting. Pandas included matplotlib. This is the one that you've been using until now. And from now on, if you have a different backend, for example, my emoji backend, now you are able to implement like plots with emojis. Like, this project is not open source, but for 1 million pesos, I can share the code. Not even know how much is that, but. So we're releasing, the plans are to release Pandas 1 this year. This is a plan. It might or might not happen because we're all volunteers and basically we invest the time we can. But yeah, it's quite likely that we're going to release Pandas 1 in like a month or two before the end of the year. Pandas 1 is not a parallel job. In the right side, you see something that you could guess that it's happening. We've been developing the zero branch to say in parallel to a one, so when you arrive to the version one, it's totally different and we fix every single problem on that. But unfortunately for you, we're in the left side, so Pandas 1 would be just an next iteration. It would be like Pandas 0.26, just like the things that we've been fixing since we released 0.25. So don't expect really like lots lots of changes, but there are some quite impressive changes. We'll start from pandas 1 to use semantic versioning. I think this is very convenient for users. This means basically that when you are in pandas 1 and you keep upgrading, your code shouldn't break. We are trying to make sure that your code don't break when you move from pandas 1 to pandas 1.1, pandas 1.2, and will break your code when you move from pandas 1 to pandas 2. You will require to fix changes and do some changes. I think that's there are other types of versioning. I think this one is the one that makes life simple for the user, so I think it's very, very good news. Something quite important is not a feature in itself, but in pandas we've got diversity problems for a while now. Pandas, like 2 years ago, it was 3 people maintaining, so I think it's like just making the project survive was a big challenge. Now we're much more people. This is like from 1.5 years ago. As you can see, all white men, all based in the US and Europe. And we've been checking some data about the contributors we've got, and all the people that I can identify a gender in here, I can guess a gender in here, and the list is longer, is also a male. I know most of them, and they are also based in Europe and the US. So we decided to change things. We started a mentoring program. So that means that as it's not a feature, but I think that having a diverse team is extremely important for users. I think like if you take one of the current developers and you clone it, it can invest probably double of the time in the project, but it cannot invest any more talent. It would be the same exact talent. And having people from different backgrounds will mean that we have much more talent, different point of views, and that will make pandas better in the future. It will take time. We're just starting, but that's gonna happen. We will have a new logo. We already have. You are the first people outside of the team to see this logo. No picture, sorry. Okay, you can try again. No. You'll have the slides anyway. Okay, I'll let you take the picture. I don't have a lot of time, but just be fast, time is running. Okay, we'll have a new website. It will be responsive. The website looks quite awful in mobile at the moment. We'll have with a new logo, new style, new design, and also something that will be very cool. We're trying to unify the navigation of the website with the rest of the projects of the ecosystem. We're talking with scikit-learn, we're talking with NumPy, SciPy. We expect that whenever you go to one of these websites, the navigation is the same or almost the same. There will probably be different because the target audience is different. Some of these projects actually are very academic. Pandas is not so academic, so there might be minor differences, but hopefully we get the ecosystem that it's all integrated and it would be much easier to navigate. We're also improving like the documentation for getting it started, for installing pandas if you are very new to that. I don't think it's the case for people here, but also the documentation like tutorials. We're building a lot of stuff. It's a lot of work, but I think we have amazing results on that. Now I'm gonna go a bit more technical. Regarding the pandas architecture, I'll give an overview. This is a simplification of how I see pandas. It's far from accurate, and it's like there is a trade-off on accuracy and simplicity. Here I'm focused on simplicity so you can understand, but this is like literally there are many side cases that might not fit in this framework. At the top of this diagram, you would have the users using pandas, that they are exposed to the rest of the pandas using the public API. The bottom of this chart, you have the hardware, you have internal representation. This data representation at the bottom is how I represent that. And then we have these like core features. Pandas is able to index and select data, reduce operations. That means that taking a column and converting it into a single value, like computing statistics, like the mean, the sum. A map means that you are taking a column and converting it to another column. Every value is assigned to something else. Reshaping, pandas provides all sorts of reshaping operations, pivot tables, combining like joins, aggregating the group by. And then there are those things that are not so core, that is like input and output of data. We have a plotting system. We also have a styler that I don't think many people is using that, but you are able to display a data frame with different colors for negative values and that, similar to what Excel provides. If you want a bit more in example, I think it's quite clear, but you would have like grid CSV to CSV, the plot, the style, dot apply, the dot log is the one of the ones for filtering and selecting, the sum, like string operations would be a map operation, like you have a stack join, plenty of them. And the representation, the data representation is NumPy arrays, is what we're using internally for that. So future work on that. The first thing and one of the most important is, let me reduce the size of this so you can see. Well, probably I don't don't think you care about the links that much. So, yeah, the data representation right now, as I said, is NumPy arrays. This is been quite all right, but in the future we might want other different types of representations. The first thing that we want to apply is to make sure that we are decoupling the data representation from the rest. So that means that here, in this part over here, we should implement a data representation API. So all the paths, when you are indexing, when you are reducing and that, you don't assume anymore that the data representation are NumPy arrays. We also have like an API that we define, so then we can replace components on the bottom and they can still access in the same way. We started work on that. There is a lot of amazing work. It's named extension arrays. But it's still assuming in many parts that those are NumPy arrays. So in many cases you need to transfer to NumPy and that can kill the performance in many ways. We'll see those things in more detail. We want better integration with Apache Arrow, that is the next evolution of the next iteration on that. When we have this dataframe API, we can represent not only with NumPy. NumPy is a great tool, but was never designed as a backend for pandas. It was designed as a linear algebra tool. Arrow is a project that started Wes McKinney 5 years ago, like seeing the challenges of using NumPy as a backend for data frame data. Efficient string data type is the next obvious iteration. Apache Arrow supports a string in a much better way than NumPy. NumPy, as I said, is linear algebra. In linear algebra, you don't care strings. NumPy was designed in a very flexible way, so you can just use pointers to Python objects. So when you have strings or you have like some other types that are not supported, you can just have like an array of pointers and then you have your memory in Python objects. But Python is not fast, so this means that you are killing the performance of your data with that. That in practice for the users, it means that we'll have like the same string operations, but they will be way much faster, like maybe an order of magnitude or even more. Integration with Numba, that's a kind of easier one and quite useful. If you've been in the community enough, you know that this is a very bad practice. You have an array, imagine a NumPy array, and you want to sum the members, the items in this array. Looping and doing any operation on that, it's something that is totally discouraged. People will laugh at you and they will tell you, no, this is not the right thing you need to do. This is what you are expected to. So actually, NumPy is doing the loop for you, but instead of doing it in Python, it's doing it in C, which means that it's like way, way much faster. This is how things have been until now, but with Numba, you can use the same function as before. You decorate with a just-in-time compiler, which means that this Numba will convert your code to C. So you don't need NumPy to implement the code, the loop in C for you, because Numba will do that. So you can still write your code in Python. You can just decorate with Numba, and this will make like programming much, much faster because Python is much easier to program than C, and the speed should be exactly the same. So this would be a huge improvement. You should be able to do that as a user using Pandas for your own custom functions, but we also want to use that internally. Pandas has a lot of C code at the moment. That means that we need to compile Pandas when we're developing it. It means that, well, it takes quite a lot of time. It also means a lot of complexity. You need to know two languages, so that should be quite a good improvement. This is in the roadmap. Yeah, I didn't say that. I'm going a bit fast because I don't have a lot of time, but in the bottom of every slide, I'm telling whether this is in the roadmap means that it's been already agreed by the core development team. There are some things in this talk that are not agreed, that are under discussion, some other ones that are just my personal proposal that most of them I didn't propose to the team yet because we have lots of things at the moment to discuss and it's too much. So the block manager, this is how Pandas is representing the data internally. This is the block manager and it's something that if you've heard someone talk about good things about the block manager, it was in your dreams because everybody hates it. This basically means that when you have a data frame and you have different types for every column, what we check is like for every column the type and then we group all the types together in NumPy arrays. The main reason for that is that if you want to do operations at root level, if I have all a data frame with all float columns and I want to compute the sum, not at column level, that is how Pandas is mainly designed, but at root level, this block manager will make things much faster. The problem with that is that adds a lot of complexity on Pandas. It causes lots of trouble and it's something that we don't really like. Still, we don't have yet, it's something that we want to rewrite and we want to fix. There is a problem. We had a survey recently to ask the users how they are using pandas, and many of them, like a significant amount, are telling that they are having like huge structures with many, many columns doing operation on them, so removing them would be a bit problematic. I think that shouldn't be a problem because there are other projects like XArray that should solve this problem in a probably better way. It's kind of like similar to pandas, but with unique types and more more dimensions. But yeah, it's something that it's quite big. It's a huge refactoring, but it's something that we really need to do, and that should simplify the internals quite a lot. This also means that, for example, if you see that all the integer columns in the first block, it means that if in this data frame I add a new column and this column is an integer, it means that I will have that block create a new block that is the same as the integer block, but with an extra column, move all that data to that block, and then get rid of that block. It means a lot of memory copying. And in pandas and in the data world in general, memory copy is the bottom. Like the CPUs are extremely fast, the memory copying is not. So most of the times the CPU is not doing anything more than waiting for memory to move. So having copying memory necessarily is making pandas much, much slower. Consistency in missing values means that I shown a bit before about missing values with floats. Now I will show with Boolean. When I'm having a column with Boolean values and a missing value, this is not a Boolean column anymore, it's an object. An object is what I mentioned before. It's just like a NumPy array of pointers, and then you have Python objects. This makes that things are very, very slow. You're in the Python world, you are not in the efficient computing world anymore. The problem is that, this is very specific that it's a float, it's a different type. If you use the NumPy NA, it's exactly the same thing, even if it's a bit more hidden that this is really a float. And the problem here is that when you are representing the data internally in the memory for, like, I'm pretty sure you know about that, like Booleans is like 0 represents false, 1 represents true, and then we have a NaN value, a third value that we don't have a value to represent. It's like 0 is taken, 1 is taken, and we don't have a 2, unless you're using quantum computers, or I don't know if those things change the paradigm, but in the computers that we're using today, we don't have more than 2 possible values, so having false, true and false, and none means that we cannot represent it with Boolean. The solution for that is we'll have a pandas NA, that it's not this float anymore, and internally what this represents is that what you intend is having true, false, and none, and what we have is actually saving the true. Well, actually, that's I made that typo here. True would be 1, this would be 0. The other one we don't care because we have a different array that we store in parallel that we say this value is not missing, this value is not missing, and this value is missing. So we don't really care about this. Could be 0 and 1, we don't really care. And when you do operations, we're aware of these two arrays, and it would be transparent for you. And you will have missing values in any possible type without problems in casts. Then we have something interesting. I was showing this representation. Here I represented, this is not how pandas is exactly designed. The blues and the greens are all together at the moment. But if you think about this representation, you can imagine that you can have different data frame programs that could still be using the same plotting as we do, the same IO as we do, the same installer as we do, that it's not part of the code. These projects already exist. We have, probably you know about Dask. I think Travis mentioned about it yesterday. It's a production-ready distributed data frame system. There is another one named Modin. It has a very interesting architecture. It's not production-ready. It's an academic project at the moment, but very promising. There is Vaex. Vaex is an out-of-core data frame. It means that it keeps your data in disk. It only loads data memory in small chunks. It means that you can have 1 terabyte of data in your disk and do operations as if it was pandas. That's a quite interesting project. You have cuDF from NVIDIA that are representing data frames on GPUs. Koalas by Spark, the people from Databricks created a data frame. All them are using the pandas API, so it should be kind of transparent for the user what you're using, but under the hood you would be using Spark. This means that if we create a data frame API, a standard API among all these projects, a simpler one than pandas, because the pandas one is here and it's too complex, it's very user-friendly, but it's not like proper design for interconnecting with other systems, then it means that if you're using Vaex or you're using something else and you want to use pandas plotting, it would be easier to connect with that, and that shouldn't be a problem. Then another step, I painted at the beginning the index at win, in the inside, but the index is something that could be decoupled. It's in the plans already. that's in the roadmap, as you can always see in the bottom. The index is something that we could decouple. Dask has several advantages. Well, the decoupling means that the index is basically having labels, having like the names of the columns and knowing which is the position. In memory, we are just having memory blocks of memory, but you can know that the column H is the third column, so you just use the name H and it's able to find that in memory. We can have a data frame that it only understands about positions and then have an indexing that is totally decoupled, is separate, that is able to do the transition, and for you it's transparent and you don't care. That has interesting things that, for example, indexing might not be useful for everyone, and especially indexing in the row axis is something that many users get annoyed because you have, in pandas you are forced to have an index in the rows, something that you don't always use and sometimes it creates confusion and problems. And also the indexing of pandas could be reused by other projects. It's already reused, for example, XArray is using that, but they have to import the whole pandas, so having a separate model should make things easier for them to be reusing this index. That should be a project available for anyone in the ecosystem. The plotting API, this is already decoupled. I showed you before that now we support different backends, which means that this is already decoupled, but we still need to decouple a bit better and have a bit simpler API. I think most of the people are using the basic API, which is quite consistent, but based on the Zen of Python, and I totally agree on every one of the points of the Zen of Python, there should be one and preferably only one way to do things. This is not the case. For example, if you want to do a box plot, that's kind of an extreme example, but you have four different ways of implementing that and not even always actually reuse the same code. There are some differences, small differences among them that are totally unnecessary. So it's something that we want to clean. One of the things that I think it would add more value is like the input and output, making it also more decoupled, creating an ecosystem and allowing an ecosystem. Many people have different formats. Those are the ones that we support, and those are the people who answer our questions on. It was around 1,000 people. Everybody's using CSV, which is a bit sad because it's not a really great format, but many people using Excel, many people using JSON, Parquet, and SQL, and XDF are kind of okay. Then we have other formats that are like Stata, SPSS, SAS, will be query, that are not that well that used. And at the moment, we have the decision as pandas developers what is possible in pandas and what is not. I think we should decouple that and allow them to be plugins. And everyone, I personally would like to see all the small ones here to be out of pandas and be third party projects that are like for the user would be transparent, but we shouldn't maintain in our code base. And that would allow you to, if you have in your company, in your industry, in your area, academic area, where you have a specific format, you have something very, very specific, you can implement that. XML, I don't know, I think there are like 1,000 formats that you could consider for that. You could export the data frame to Markdown, that is something that we currently don't support, but I'm sure people would find use cases for that. So I think creating an ecosystem would be great. And the last point, the last big point I've got in pandas at the moment, if you have, see, a serious object, it has 465 properties. Of these, around 220 or 240 are public. It means that the API is huge and it's very difficult having everything in the same namespace in the top domain makes things very difficult to compare, because you have the internal properties, you have like the statistical methods, everything is a direct method in there, almost everything, not everything. This means also that if you are, for example, using the min, but it will work in an integer, but it won't work here. So you have this series, but depending on the type of your data, this is not even working, which is a bit annoying. Then we have something that we call the accessor. It means that certain operations, like for example the string operations or the date operations, actually live in a different namespace, live under this str and this. Again, you can still call this from there, so it exists. So a possible option that's not yet a proposal would be to instead of having this representation here, that the data representation is separate from the course, we could have that the reduce and the map operations that are the one type of specific could be implemented with the type, and then we just propagate in some sort of namespace. That's kind of tricky, but that's like interesting. Sorry, I have one more thing. Multiple users, I'm running out of time, I'm sorry about that. Multiple users API, I wrote a blog post a few months ago about the two cultures of pandas, because in pandas, when you're using in a notebook, it's quite a nice API to experiment with. It makes things very easy. But when you're a data engineer, it's having too much magic. It's converting types automatically, inferring types. It's doing a lot of magic that it's very, very inconvenient. So we could have actually different APIs on top of this. I was representing a single API. We could have the pandas API that, as I showed, is serving well users, to have SQL operations. That's an obvious one. And then we have other APIs more convenient for that. For example, an SQL API could be something like that. Another API that could be more intuitive for data engineering and less magic could be just like the reduce operation. Just specify, be explicit that this is a reduce. You, from the code, is telling you exactly which kind of value is going to return. The map operations could be more specific. And finally, we're working in other things that are more like housekeeping, like we're improving the documentation, the performance monitoring, we're simplifying the CI. There is lots of things in the roadmap that affect the users that much. And that's all. Thank you very much. Yeah, you have the slides in this link. I'll be also posting on Twitter, on LinkedIn. I'll be sharing them too.
Ok, entonces otra vez por cuestiones de tiempo vamos a tener tiempo para una única pregunta. ¿Qué? La rifamos. ¿Preguntas?
An easy one.
So, no one, really? Ok. No. Use it because there's only one question left.
I'm going to make the question in English. Is there going to be like support for GPUs in pandas?
It's going to be what, sorry?
GPUs, like using CUDA cores for...
My view is something that, I mean, not in pandas at the moment, there is cuDF. I don't know in which stage it is. I think we'll be able to to answer. I don't think pandas is huge. I don't think any of the pandas, let's say, competitors or pandas alternatives is as stable and as big as pandas. I don't know exactly what's the state of that. cuDF is a replacement. My personal view is that cuDF shouldn't replace the whole of pandas. We should be defining these data frame APIs, these data representation APIs, and NVIDIA should be focusing on the parts that they really care. I don't think NVIDIA has any interest in making plotting better, or if they have, I'm quite sure they are happy to make plotting better for any of the pandas, to say, the different options. So, yeah, I think that, but that's kind of like for the long term. But I think personally, we should have like a single project where you have a different backend and you say, okay, my data representation is in GPU, my data representation is in Spark. We unite forces and where it makes sense. And every stakeholder, like if you want out of core data, you can use Vaex, but Vaex doesn't need to reimplement everything. First, because I don't think it's feasible. Like several of the developers of these tools, they told me, yeah, it's possible, we can reimplement all the pandas. I spent the last 2 years only trying to document all pandas, and I think we're at 10% of it. So if they are able to reimplement everything, including the documentation, I'll be very happy to copy the documentation from them and bring it to pandas. But personally, I don't trust that. I don't buy that. So I think we need to unite forces and try to find synergies and reuse code as much as we can.